Good evening to all. I welcome you all to the 11th online lecture of the course Experimental Methods in Thermal Engineering. In our last lecture, we started our discussion on measurement of fluid properties, and in particular, we have discussed various instruments which are used for measuring the density of the fluids. Okay. In today's lecture, particularly, we will be targeting the measurement of another fluid property, which is known as viscosity. So I have already described you the basic formulation of viscosity. So it's nothing but when we are having some shear stress and rate of shear strain, the relationship between the two is actually dependent upon some factor, and that factor actually we are calling as viscosity. Okay. So what we have to do over here, I have already told you that in terms of viscosity, we are having three different measurement principles. So the very first principle was of oscillating or vibrating bodies within the fluid mediums, and the second is related to the capillary measurement, capillary flow based measurements, and third type of device I have told you, where we are having free fall of solid objects in our fluid for which we want to measure the viscosity. Okay. So we will try to see individually each of these. So particularly in first type of device, whatever we are having based on oscillations and vibrations of the solid objects, what particularly will be happening? It's nothing but we will be having second order system. So we will be having some governing equation which will be giving us the oscillation. So describing the characteristics of the oscillation. So that's nothing but we are having a second order system, and this second order system, particularly what we will be doing, we will be giving some impulse type of input. Okay, so for example, if you take the case of a simple pendulum, so what we do in case of a simple pendulum, we are having some mass which is attached to a thread, and then what we do, we give certain initial deflection to this pendulum, and because of that, what happens, this pendulum actually keep on oscillating between the extreme values. Okay, so that will be oscillating if we are having perfect vacuum, and if we are having some surrounding fluid resistance, so because of that, what will be happening, the amplitude of the oscillations will be actually decreasing in the consecutive time periods of oscillations. Okay, so over here we can call that our vibrating and oscillating systems are nothing but of second order systems. And in these particular second order systems, what we will try to see, we will try to first we will be giving some impulse type of input, and based on that impulse input, what we will be getting finally, we will be nothing but getting the simple harmonic output. Okay, so we will be getting harmonic output from here. So we are giving impulse input, and nature of the system is second order, and what we will be finally getting, nothing but harmonic output out of that impulse input. Okay, and particularly what will be happening when we will be doing these oscillations, when we will be observing for the solid body, the oscillation will be having no dissipation when it is happening in the absolute vacuum, and when we are doing or observing the oscillations of the solid objects in the presence of fluid, then depending upon the density and the viscosity of the fluids, there will be some damping, and the nature we will be finding that the amplitude of the oscillations will be actually decreasing in the consistent or consecutive periods. Okay, so that is the actually main principle, that we are nothing but we are having a second order system, and to this second order system we are giving some impulse input from which we are getting the harmonic output. Okay, and the nature of harmonic output will be actually changing when we will be studying these oscillations of the solid object in our fluid. Okay, so let us first see the general description. First, I am telling you about the oscillating body viscometer. So, in case of oscillating body viscometers, what we do, we consider axially symmetric bodies and which are suspended from a torsion wire, so that body performs oscillations. But as we are having the torsion wire, so obviously the nature of the oscillations will be angular. So we will be having angular oscillations of the body. Okay, and these oscillations will be performed inside some fluid, and that will be happening about the axis of symmetry of that body. Okay, then particularly what we are having, the different options over here. We are having axis symmetric body as cylindrical objects, spherical objects, we are having certain cup type arrangements also. So fluid is usually surrounds the oscillator. So normally we are having that, we will be having the solid object, and in its surroundings we will be having fluid. But there are few specific type of solid objects, particularly the case of sphere or the case of cup, where fluid can also be inside the solid object. Okay, then we are having some suspension wire to which actually our body is attached, which will be undergoing some oscillation. So the wire is of elastic nature. Okay, and system is gently rotated to start here motion. So it means we are giving some initial impulse input gently to our system. Okay, so then we are having this omega, omega naught, delta and delta naught. So omega is nothing but we know the frequency of oscillations. Okay, and delta is something which is known as the logarithmic decrement. Okay, so probably you all have taken the course on mechanical vibration, so you all might be familiar with the term logarithmic decrement, which is nothing but delta equal to 1 by n ln of x at some time t divided by x at some time t plus n into t, where capital T represents the period of oscillation. So what we try to do, we try to measure the amplitude x of any object at particular time, and then the amplitude immediately after the next cycle. Okay, one cycle is completed, then we will try to take the ratio of that amplitude, and whatever the decrement is happening over here, that decrement will be nothing but called as because we are considering log over here, so we call this type of decrement as logarithmic decrement in our vibrations. Okay, and if we are having the perfect vacuum, in that case we will be having zero value for decrement. Okay, then we are having some subscripts also attached over here. So this subscript zero is nothing but refers to the oscillation characteristics when oscillations are happening in absolute vacuum. Okay, and omega and delta are corresponding to the surrounding fluid medium. Okay, then one more important point we have to remember over here, while we are giving the initial induced perturbations, these should be so small so that our system should remain in almost near equilibrium state. Okay, so I have already told you that for this type of things, we will be nothing but having some second order equation in our time domain. So if we convert that second order differential equation in the Laplacian form, we will be finding nothing but s plus delta naught square plus 1 plus d of s is equal to 0. So this is nothing but our generic nature of the equation. Now we know that roots for long-term behavior for this type of equation will be nothing but plus minus iota minus delta into theta, where theta is equal to tau naught by tau, and this tau nothing but represents the time period of oscillations. So this tau is time period of oscillations. Okay, now if you have to determine the angular displacement of axially symmetric body, so we know that nothing but when we are giving some impulse input, we will be having harmonic output. Okay, so for the displacement, we will be having harmonic nature, where a naught into e times minus delta theta omega naught t, this is nothing but our amplitude of oscillations, and this amplitude is having exponential decay, and that exponential decay is actually the function of logarithmic decrement, frequency of oscillations and time. Okay, and then we are having one cos term over here, so that is nothing but that will be showing us the repetitive nature of the oscillations. Okay, so this is the generic system behavior what I have described over here. Now particularly this characteristic equation, when you will be submitting substituting the value of this s in our generic equation, we will be getting some of the terms which are having iota associated and some of the terms which are not having iota. Okay, so finally if you separate out the real part and imaginary part of this characteristic equation, we will be having nothing but these two equations. Okay, so particularly over here, if you see in terms of real equations, we are having the order of this parameter theta in square term, and over here we are having nothing but order of theta as unity only. Okay, so probably in terms of order of accuracy or uncertainty of measurement, if we see the measurement of imaginary part of the equation will be more accurate in comparison to that of, or I should say more precise in comparison to that of the measurement of the real power. Okay. Then one important point comes over here. So now we are only discussing about the generic nature of the oscillations, but while we have to devise our system, so what we have to do, we have to select certain dimensions of the our solid body, whatever the solid objects are there. So particularly for that, one factor is very, very important, which is called as the boundary layer thickness. And this over here is nothing but having formulation as mu divided by rho times omega naught square root of the entire thing. So this particular thing is called as natural length scale, and this is a very, very important parameter which will be required for designing the dimensions of the oscillating body, whatever we will be using in our experiments. Okay. Then one particular example is included over here, particularly for the oscillating disc quartz viscometer. So in this particular viscometer, what we are having nothing but over here, you can see this quartz disc is over here, and then above this disc, we are having some stationary fixed plate. So one plate is this one, and another plate is also there below this disc. Now this disc is connected to some thin quartz wire. Okay. And this wire, across this wire, so this is nothing but considered as the axis of oscillations of this wire. Okay. So particularly for this type of disc arrangement, if you find out the characteristic equation, that characteristic equation will be nothing but ds equal to pi into r to power 4, where our r is nothing but radius of the disc. Okay. So this r is nothing but equal to that of radius of disc. This capital I represents the moment of inertia of the disc. So this is moment of inertia. Okay. So Cn is then another term. So this is a some factor which depends upon the linear dimensions of the instrument. So what is its detailed formulation, we will see in the next slide. And then we are having some terms beta 1, beta 2 over here. Okay. So you can see beta 1 is nothing but equal to B1 by delta. This delta is nothing but represents the natural length scale, what I have described in the previous slide. And B1 represents the spacing from the disc surface to the top plate. And B2 represents the spacing from the disc surface to the bottom plate. So particularly over here, what I have told you, that we are having nothing but two additional plates. So one plate over here, then one plate over here. And between these two plates, we are having our disc, which will be actually having some oscillations. Okay. So the distance from the surface, top surface of disc to the bottom surface of plate, we are calling as B1, and this distance over here we are calling as nothing but B2. Okay. So one important point we have to remember over here, that these two particular plates are included in order to avoid the spurious convection effects into our fluid medium. Okay. So what we want to do, we want to have perfect shearing in between the fluid medium. So fluid outside should be completely stationary. So in that case, and because of the oscillations only, it should create some damping effect over our disc. So generally, if we are having the infinitely large fluid medium, so in that case, what will be happening? There may be some spurious currents because of the natural convection. So in order to avoid these spurious currents, these additional two plates will be plates are given, which will be actually confining the flow near the disc periphery. Okay. And then B factor is defined over here, like by considering the harmonic mean of B1 and B2, and then beta is defined as B by delta. Okay. So this type of particular equation, whatever is stated over here, this will be only applicable when our dimensions B1 plus B2 plus D are nothing but less than R. Okay. Here, this small d represents the thickness of the disc. Okay, so R is radius, and small d is nothing but thickness of the disc, which we have considered over here. Okay, so corresponding to the natural length scale, we are having condition B1 plus B2 plus D should be very small in comparison to natural length scale delta. Okay, so these conditions are only met if we are having dilute and moderately dense gas. plates. Okay, so this type of then disc type viscometers is particularly having applications in the atmospheric states when we are having some dense or dilute gases actually. Okay, then CN, as I told you, it's nothing but some instrumental constant, and it depends upon the linear dimensions of the oscillatory object. And particularly it is unity if we are having disc of infinite radius and zero thickness. Okay, so over here you can see the equation of CN. So this is the equation for CN, which nothing but involves the terms theta, which is the ratio of tau naught by tau, where tau is period of oscillation, and delta, which is nothing but our logarithmic decrement. And I, R4, B, all these are nothing but the dimensions of the disk, and rho will be having our disk material density. Okay. So particularly over here, I have also defined few more constants, F1, F2, F3. So these individual constants are having this formulation, and particularly you have to just remember one point over here, that symbol D1 over here is nothing but referring to distance D1. Similarly, symbol D2 is actually referring to distance B2 over here. Okay. Then finally, if you see, what will be happening particularly for any of the instrument, this value of C1 will be actually already known. Now, with this particular value of Cn, if we solve this equation by knowing the values of delta and theta for the value of beta, so that value of beta is something which is actually related to the viscosity of the fluid medium. So you can see over here that absolute viscosity mu depends upon omega times omega naught times rho into b square divided by beta square, where beta square is nothing but obtained from this particular equation of Cn. So for a particular device, we know the value of Cn, which is a fixed parameter for any given device, because it depends upon the type of the oscillating material. And then we will be measuring the values of theta and delta, and based on these values, when we will be actually solving this particular equation, we will be finding the roots of beta. And when we substitute the roots of beta square over here, we will be finding nothing but the absolute value of the viscosity. Okay, so this is particularly used for gases at room temperature in pressure range from 0.1 to 60 megapascals, and it is used with uncertainty limits of 0.1%. Okay, so one of the incident from the literature I have included over here, apart from this, by using certain modifications, it has been employed for measuring the density of liquids also under certain specific conditions. Okay, so which I am not actually including over here. I have just given you one of the principal application of this type of device. Okay, then another type of device is nothing but oscillating cylinder viscometer. So in case of oscillating cylinder viscometer, that is nothing but a thick disc. So thickness will be increasing, so cross section will be circular only, but in case of disc, the thickness was very small. Over here we will be having thick disc, and thick disc particularly we can call as nothing but cylindrical configuration. Okay, so we are having a cylindrical body, and which will be actually oscillating inside some infinite fluid. And then it is used for absolute measurement of low viscosity fluids up to temperature of 1200 degrees Celsius, and uncertainty level for water when this type of instrument was employed, it was 0.1% with special efforts, means when additional care has been given to reduce the errors. Okay, however, if we do the routine measurements, we do not go for additional careful experimentation, then the uncertainty was of the order of around 1%. Okay, so only difference will be that instead of having a thin disc, now we will be having thick disc, which will be identical to that of a cylindrical configuration. Then next we are having oscillating cup type of viscometer. So in case of oscillating cup type of viscometer, the difference will be that instead of having a solid cylinder, now we will be having some hollow cup like arrangement. Okay, so this type of arrangement we will be having, and the fluid, instead of having outside over here, we will be having the fluid which will be filled inside this. Okay, so now there may be two configurations. Either this cup can be fully filled, or this cup can be partially filled. Okay, so whatever the characteristic equation is included over here, this is for the configuration where our cup is actually fully filled. And what we have done over here, if we consider this R as the radius of the cup, in that case, we can define some parameter zeta, which is nothing but equal to delta by r, and we are having some constants over here. The values of these constants are represented over here in terms of ratio of r by h. Okay, so r is nothing but radius of the cup, and h is something which represents the height of the hollow portion of the cup. Okay, so using these values, these constants can be determined, and this above equation can be actually solved. Okay, so particularly this type of device is used for measuring the viscosity of mercury, molten salts, and hydrocarbon, etc. And the maximum uncertainty was 1.5%. There were certain cases where uncertainty was even less than plus minus 0.5%, or even in the limit of 0.1% also. But whatever the measurements were done in the literature, out of that, the maximum uncertainty was actually up to 1.5%. Okay. Then we have one more type of viscometer. So here, what we can do, instead of having the cylindrical body, we may have spherical body also. Okay. So here also, we may have once again the two configurations. Either this sphere can be filled with the fluid inside a spherical cell, or we may have some solid sphere which will be actually having the oscillations in some surrounding fluid medium. Okay. But one difficulty of this type of device is that it is difficult to manufacture with the sufficiently precise spherical cell. Okay. And one more thing is also there, as it offers very little advantage over the simpler cylindrical configurations, which are easy to manufacture. That's why this type of device has not been actually popular for measuring the viscosity. Okay, so these were the two major drawbacks that spherical type viscometers have not become very popular. Okay, and particularly when it was used in the past, it has been employed for measuring the viscosity of molten salts. And moreover, whatever the uncertainties were reported with these measurements, these were nothing but higher than disc and cup type viscometers. Okay. Then another type of arrangement is something which is called as vibrating viscometer. So vibrating viscometer, now the principle is identical to that of the oscillating viscometers. Now the only difference is that here we will be having actually vibrations of the object, of an elastic object. Okay. So for example, if I have one wire, metallic wire, which is of elastic nature. So if I deflect this wire, if I provide some initial deflection to this, what will be happening? It will be nothing but showing some sinusoidal oscillations, okay, in certain plane, which the plane will be actually passing through the axis of the wire, okay. And then what we can do, if these oscillations are particularly happening inside a fluid medium, then by measuring the damping of the oscillations, actually we can relate it to the viscosity of the fluid medium, okay. So over here, oscillations involves periodic distortions of the solid body. So we will be having solid body, and distortion of the solid body itself actually giving us nothing but the vibrations. And this is mechanically simple in comparison to the oscillating body viscometers. And volume of fluid which is required with this type of so measurements, that is also relatively less in comparison to the volume required for oscillating type measurements. Okay. Then it's also suitable for measuring the viscosity at high pressure and high temperatures. Okay. So what we are having over here, we have included the configuration of a vibrating wire viscometer. So we are having nothing but a wire which is connected to some fixed arrangement, and close to this wire, we are having some permanent magnets over here. So nothing but what we will be doing, we will be supplying certain current we will be passing through this wire for an just an instant in order to have some impulse input. And because of that current, there will be certain deformation of the wire, because it is actually subjected inside some permanent magnetic field. Okay. And in order to keep this wire always in tension, some weight is actually attached over the wire. Okay. So now what we will be doing, just a current will be passed through the wire just for giving the initial distortion, and after that what will be happening, there will be certain arrangement for actually measuring the distortions of the wire between these permanent magnets. So particularly nothing is done, what will be happening when this wire will be actually oscillating or vibrating in between the permanent magnets. There will be some development of current signal within the wire. Okay, so that current signal is actually reported while the wire is actually subjected to the vibrations. Okay, so what we are having over here, nothing but thin circular cross section wire of radius r and density rho s, which is subjected to tension. So it is subjected to tension with the help of some weight which is attached over there. And then what we are having, it performs transverse oscillations, particularly about its axis in a single plane, okay, which is containing the axis. Then displacement will be having nothing but of harmonic nature. So we are defining with zeta as displacement is nothing but a times e power minus delta omega t sine omega t plus phi. And this type of displacement behavior will be when we are having nothing but larger time intervals, okay. But initially during the short time intervals, because we are giving initial pulse also, so we will be having some transient response also. So this f of t nothing but it represents the initial transient response. So what we do while we do the measurements, we actually avoid initial 2 to 3 cycles, because that these cycles are actually affected by the initial transient response. So once the initial 3-4 cycles are done, after that whatever the response is actually shown by this oscillating wire, that is used to relate it to the density, viscosity of the fluid. Okay, and this instrument is actually particularly designed for following constraints. So over here you can see that value of omega should be greater than epsilon, and it should be smaller than 1 by epsilon square, where epsilon is nothing but zeta max divided by r. Zeta max represents the maximum displacement of the wire. Okay, and then we are having this omega as nothing but equal to rho omega r square by mu. And one more constraint we are having, omega into epsilon multiplied by r by c should be very small in comparison to unity, where c is nothing but the sonic velocity in the fluid medium, whatever we are having under consideration. Okay. So for this type of vibrating wire viscometer, logarithmic decrement delta, which I have already told you as nothing but equal to 1 by n ln of displacement zeta at time t divided by displacement zeta at time t plus capital T. Okay, so that is what I have told you earlier, that in between the two consecutive cycles, whatever we will be having the displacement or the amplitude, the ratio of that is something which is given by the logarithmic decrement. So over here you can see this logarithmic decrement is nothing but related to the density as well as the viscosity. Okay, so these constants k1, k and k dash are given over here with the help of these formulations. And where we are having a as nothing but equal to iota minus delta naught times 1 plus 2 k1 s divided by s k naught s. Okay, where s is nothing but equal to iota minus delta into omega square root. Okay, so that is something which is coming from the dynamic analysis of the system. So over here actually we are more interested in measuring the value of viscosity. So that's why what I am trying to do, I am giving you the equations directly, and I am explaining that how these equations are actually related to the value of viscosity, which can be employed for designing our system. Okay, so over here you can see this k naught and k one; these are nothing but the modified Bessel functions. And what we have to do over here, we have to apply one correction, which is nothing but greater than 0.01% in order to account for the boundary effect. So normally, what we do while this analysis and these equations are designed, it is considered that we are having in the surroundings infinitely large fluid pool. Okay, but in actual practice, we cannot have infinite size for the fluid pool. We will be having some cylindrical container. Okay, and there will be some fluid medium in contact with the container wall, and whatever, because of the oscillations, there will be some disturbance inside the fluid. These disturbance will be actually ultimately reaching to the wall also. So in order to account for the boundary effects, means association of this interaction of the fluid with the wall, some correction is actually included over here. Okay, and particularly for this type of devices, uncertainty was less than 3%. Then another more variant of the vibration viscometer. So over here nothing but vibrations are actually done in once again torsional manner. Okay, so the device is torsional crystal viscometer. So the advantage of this particular type of device is that it is used for large viscosity range. So it is having the range of viscosity from 10 to 10 to power 5 micropascal second. Okay, and crystal motion. So we are having some torsional crystal over here, and the motion of the crystal is actually very small, and it is of very high frequency. Okay, and the cylinder is made up of piezoelectric material, and with it, its axis along the x-axis. And what we do, we provide some sinusoidal voltage across the four electrodes. So because of that sinusoidal voltage, what it will be doing, it will be actually showing some oscillations. Okay, torsional oscillations. And this cylinder will be actually vibrating with a pure internal torsional motion. And shear wave, so what will be happening over here, in between the cylinder surface which is oscillating and in the surrounding liquid medium, there will be some shear wave will develop between the fluid medium, and that will be actually, as long as we will be moving away from the surface of the cylinder, the magnitude of that shear wave will be actually decreasing because of the viscous dissipation. So over here what is done, viscous drag is exerted by the fluid on the surface of the crystal, and that changes the crystal's resonant frequency, conductance, and bandwidth at resonance. So particularly the density and viscosity of the fluid medium are related to the bandwidth Fe, ratio of M by S. M is nothing but the mass of the cylinder. Okay, so over here, and then we are having this delta which represents the logarithmic decrement, and F naught represents the bandwidth corresponding to the perfect vacuum. Okay, and then we are having crystalline quartz, which is usually selected as the piezoelectric material. So over here, if we are employing this type of torsional crystal viscometers, one advantage is there, it is applicable for the large range of viscosity measurements. But one small thing we have to consider, that we should have already the value of density known from some other independent measurement. Okay, and the estimated uncertainty with this type of device was nothing but less than 2%. Okay, so this is all about oscillating type viscometers. So where what we are doing, basically the change in oscillating or vibrating behavior of the solid object is actually employed to relate it with the viscosity of the surrounding medium. Okay, another type of device which is used for the measurement of viscosity is nothing but capillary type viscometer. So this type of device actually employs the principles of fluid mechanics for finding out the viscosity. Okay, so in this particular type of device, what is basically done, we take a very long capillary tube, and at the ends of this capillary tube we take some bulbs or some expansion volumes. So these are nothing but some expansion volumes, and these expansion volumes are particularly given in order to measure the pressure drop across this capillary tube, and fluid is actually allowed to flow through this capillary tube. Okay, and now what will be happening, when fluid will be flowing, experimentally we can measure the pressure drop, and then that pressure drop is nothing but related to the viscosity of the fluid medium. So we try to relate the relationship in between the viscosity and the pressure drop to find out the value of viscosity. Okay, so this type of device is particularly based on the principle of Hagen-Poiseuille flow. So we are having nothing but equation of Hagen-Poiseuille flow. So this type of equation is valid for axisymmetric pipe flows, and the condition is, it is applicable for laminar flow condition. Okay, and we are having nothing but the type of fluid as incompressible fluid. So these are the conditions under which this equation is actually applicable, and this equation nothing but relates the pressure drop delta P with the viscosity. Okay, so we are having the relation as delta P is nothing but equal to 8 pi mu times L into Q divided by pi square A square, where we are considering A as nothing but the radius of the capillary tube. Okay, Q is the flow rate of the fluid, and delta P is nothing but we are having pressure drop across the two ends of the capillary tube, and mu is the viscosity and L is length of the capillary tube. So this is nothing but standard Hagen-Poiseuille flow situation which we study in our fluid mechanics course when we are having axisymmetric pipe flow, and that too we are considering that we are having incompressible fluid, and the condition of flow or regime of flow is nothing but laminar. Okay, now this particular Hagen-Poiseuille equation is actually modified, and this equation is modified in order to account for the kinetic energy correction and end correction. Okay, so what we mean by these two terms, nothing but end correction refers to what will be happening when the fluid will be coming from this expanded surface into the inlet of the capillary tube. So this particular type of Hagen-Poiseuille equation considers that we are having nothing but perfectly developed parabolic velocity profile. Okay, so that perfectly parabolic velocity profile will be developing at certain length from the inlet, and we will be having certain portion near the inlet where the profile of velocity is not actually perfectly parabolic. So because of that, we include some correction factor which is known as the end correction factor, and then another correction comes because of the kinetic energy correlation. So whatever the pressure experimentally we will be measuring over here, that pressure will be nothing but delta P total, which will be static pressure plus dynamic pressure. Dynamic pressure will be nothing but equal to half rho into V square. So now what we have to do, while we will be actually relating, so we will be doing the corrections of this dynamic pressure also into our consideration. Okay, so for that purpose, this modified equation, so this was the original Hagen-Poiseuille flow equation, and after including these corrections for kinetic energy and for end, we are now having the relation of viscosity as pi a to power 4 delta p divided by 8 q l plus n into a minus m rho q divided by 8 pi l plus n. So over here this n is nothing but this is a end correction factor. So n refers to end correction factor, and m refers to the kinetic energy correction. So factor m is nothing but refers to the correction factor for kinetic energy. Okay, so now what we will be having over here, different scientists have actually given the values of m and n under the range of some experimental conditions. So you can see over here, Kestin in 1973 has given the relation of m as nothing but equal to m naught plus 8n divided by Reynolds number, and this relation is particularly applicable when Reynolds number is in the limits of 0.5 to 100. Okay, and value of m naught is given as 1.17 plus minus 0.03 and n as 0.69 plus minus 0.4. Then one more scientist has given the values of m and n particularly for the range of Reynolds number from 106 to 648. So these values are over here. Then one more relationship is there for the values of m and n, and that is applicable in the range of Reynolds number from 46 to 1466. Okay, so over here nothing but our arrangement is very simple. We will be having one capillary tube, and flow will be happening inside that capillary tube, and experimentally we will be measuring the pressure drop, and that pressure drop is nothing but with the help of this equation, whatever we are having over here is directly related to our viscosity term. Okay, so one of the viscometer is included over here for your understanding based on the capillary principle. So you can see over here that we are having this as one capillary tube, and inside this below this capillary tube we are having one bulb, and above also we are having one more another bulb over here. Okay, and this particular capillary tube is actually included or connected to a injector. So over here we are having some injector which is nothing but a kind of piston cylinder device, and this piston cylinder device will be actually containing our sample liquid inside, and it will be pumping the liquid sample into our capillary tube. Okay, so first it will be filling this entire capillary tube with our sample. Then apart from that, we are having one auxiliary bath. So this bath nothing but represents that in the surroundings we are having some liquid, and this liquid is actually maintained at some temperature, because like density, the value of viscosity also changes with temperature and pressure. So that's why what we are having in the surrounding to each of the measurement unit, we are having some liquid which is actually maintaining the temperature. And over here you can see we are having some thermometer attached in each bar to record the temperature. Okay, then apart from that, you can see over here this bulb is actually connected to some U-tube type device. So you can see one end of the this U-tube is connected to atmosphere, and another end is actually, so we are having one header over here which is connecting these two ends, and another end of this is actually connected to some depth gauge. Okay, and this black colored fluid, whatever we are having over here, this is nothing but mercury. Okay, and this particular secondary fluid is also supplied with the help of an injector. So we are having one injector for mercury also, and this injector is actually having some valve arrangement over here. So we are having certain valves which will be actually governing the direction of the flow. So particularly flow will be going from this injector. Okay, so particularly you can see over here that this is our injector. So this will be supplying the flow of mercury through these tubings, and this valve will allow this flow to enter from here and enter inside this header. So we are having over here one header which is actually having multiple outputs over here. Okay, and then we are having one return tube which will be taking the excessive mercury from our header, and it will be once again taking it to the reservoir. So we are having over here some reservoir of mercury. Okay, now what will be happening, once we have filled the fluid over here, after that what we will be doing, with the help of this mercury injection, we will be allowing that or pushing that fluid to flow into this capillary, and with the help of this U-tube manometer, why once again considering the mercury as manometric fluid, the pressure drop is actually measured. Okay, and that pressure drop is actually related to the viscosity, as I have told you in our previous slide. Okay, then this type of capillary devices have also given very simple arrangement when we want to measure the viscosity of the fluid in the atmospheric conditions. Okay, so particularly you can see over here one viscometer we are having, that is called as the capillary master viscometer. So in case of capillary master viscometer, what we are having some straight tube, and then we are having very long capillary tube over here. Okay, so length you can see is very large, and then we are having over here some cylindrical expansion chamber in the lower portion, and in the upper portion also the size of the expansion chamber is actually slightly big. And what we are having over here, certain marks are actually, certain markings are done over here. So you can see this is our first mark, then this is our second mark, and this is our third mark. So what particularly is done in this type of viscometers, in this type of viscometers actually our sample liquid is first loaded into this first chamber, and this will be actually filling the liquid inside our entire tube. And after that, what we will be measuring, we will be measuring that when our meniscus of the liquid is changing from first mark to the second mark, then how much time it has taken for change of the level of meniscus. It means between the two marks, we are knowing that we are having, say, some fixed V amount of volume. So nothing but we are trying to find out that because of the gravity, okay, so we are now having driving force as nothing but our gravity. So because of the gravity, we are trying to measure that through this capillary tube, when flow has happened, how much time it has taken to flow through it certain fixed amount of volume. Okay, so generally what will be happening over here, if you see, nothing but our equation got modified. So wherever we were having the Q in the earlier equation, now our Q flow rate will be nothing but volume between the two marks divided by time taken by our device in order to allow that flow to happen. Okay, so V by T is coming over here. So this V by T is coming over here. So now to this device, I have, if you see over here, I have called capillary master and capillary routine viscometer. So the difference between master and routine viscometer is that master viscometers are actually actually the master viscometer stake, or I can say that the experimental time is actually very large in the case of the master viscometers. And these are particularly employed for when we have to go for very highly accurate measurements. Okay, so for this particular type of master viscometers, what we can do, these all constants will be actually derived from the parameters of the viscometer. So over here you can get all these values either from the measurements during the initial design or from the properties. So we are having over here, and based on that actually we can find out the value of this constant, and ultimately we will be finding that nothing but our viscosity is related with the time only. Okay, and then we are having certain routine viscometers. So two of the routine viscometers I have included over here. However, there are large number of designs available for routine viscometers also. So for routine viscometers, actually the construction may look to you very complex, but ultimately what we are having, the disadvantage is that the size of the capillary length is actually very, very small. So because of that, whatever the measurements we will be taking, these are not having a very good uncertainty. So particularly in this type of measurements also, what is related to this whole term is called as some constant C1 times T minus this whole term is as C2 divided by T. And what generally is done, first some reference fluids are taken for which viscosity value is already known, and then experiments are first repeated for the reference fluids, and values of constants C1 and C2 are determined. Once the values of C1 and C2 are known, then test fluid are actually put inside these viscometers, and then a value of viscosity or time is recorded for this type of test fluids, and then their viscosity value is actually found. Okay, so the only advantage of routine viscometers is that their measurement time is actually less, and this type of routine viscometers are particularly employed for measurement of viscosity when we are doing the measurement of viscosity for certain applications where too much accuracy is actually not needed. Okay, then another arrangement we are having, that is particularly for the high pressure gas capillary viscometer. So if you recall to my previous slide, I have mentioned that we are taking one condition of incompressible flow. Okay, so what will be happening particularly at the high pressure conditions, what will be happening, we will be having some compressibility effects also. Okay, so because of the increase in pressure of the fluid, particularly for the gaseous mediums, there will be some compressibility factors which will be coming into picture. So what is basically done, whatever the initial equation we were having, that equation is actually modified in order to account for the compressibility effect. Okay, so over here you can see nothing but in the first term we have got one factor P1 plus P2 divided by 2P1, and in the second term instead of M, now we are having M plus log of P1 divided by P2. Okay, so these two additional factors are actually taken while we are measuring the viscosity. So over here you can see nothing but we are having some pressure vessel, and our entire device is actually kept inside the pressure condition. So obviously while we will be actually designing this type of capillary type viscometers for high pressure applications, in that case the material of the viscometer should also be selected such that it can withstand the high pressures. Okay, and what we are having over here, generally we represent this coefficient of damping zeta over here with 2.16 mu times square root of 4 divided by pi P1 plus P2 into rho, and damping velocity correction term over here, then we can simply relate viscosity to that of the first part only. And in order to account for the second term, now we will be having one additional coefficient as 1 plus 4 zeta by a, okay, where zeta is the yes. Then another type of viscometer is available, which I have already told you as nothing but falling body viscometer. So in case of falling body viscometer, what is done, we take infinitely large stagnant liquid, okay, and inside that stagnant liquid we actually allow any of the solid object to fall. So solid object can be a sphere, it can be a cylinder, okay, and it can be of any other specific shape, but the only one condition is that it should be axisymmetric. Okay, so in this particular type of device, what we do basically, we consider the conditions of Stokes flow. Okay, why Stokes flow? Because when this freely falling object will be falling inside a viscous liquid, inside that viscous liquid, its Reynolds number of the flow will be very, very small. Okay, so in order to maintain the Stokes flow condition, which is also known as the creeping flow condition, one criteria should satisfy that our Reynolds number should be lesser than 1. Okay, so then only we will be able to apply this type of viscometer devices. Okay, so in this, what is basically done, we'll be having some freely falling object inside the liquid, and then we'll be having two our solid object has already achieved its terminal velocity within the liquid medium. Okay, and then this location of the detector, we can see that at what instant actually our object has passed through the detector 1 and detector 2, and difference of that will be telling us the time to cover this length L, which is there in between the two detectors. Okay, so now particularly we can see when we are having the falling sphere viscometers, we will be nothing but having drag force which will be acting on the spherical object. So the relationship is included over here. Mu is nothing but equal to 2a square, where a represents the radius of the sphere, into density of sphere minus rho divided by 9l, where l is the length and g is gravitational acceleration and t is nothing but time required to cover length l. Okay, so apart from that, what we are doing, we are having one correction factor Fw over here. So this correction factor is nothing but included to account for the wall effects. So once again, what we will be having, we cannot always take infinite large cylindrical container. So we will be having some cylindrical container over here. So in order to account for the wall effect, actually some constant is actually given. And you can see the value of this constant can be related to the radius of the sphere divided by the radius of the cylindrical container. So capital R is nothing but our radius of cylindrical container, whatever we are doing. Okay, so with that we can relate. Okay, then we are having another type of device where we are having falling cylinder viscometer. So particularly for falling cylinder viscometers, we are having relation in between viscosity, we can find as 1 minus rho divided by rho s, where rho s is nothing but the density of solid material. So density of the solid cylinder material. Okay, and then this coefficient A nothing but two lengths, LS and LT. So LS represents the length of the cylinder. So this is nothing but length of the cylinder, and this LT is nothing but the length during which we have actually measured the time period. Okay, so now in this type of cylinder type viscometers, falling cylinder viscometers, we are having one advantage, because I told you that this principle is only applicable. Of cylinder type viscometer is that instead of having a solid cylinder, we can go for hollow cylinder. Okay, so what will be happening in case of hollow cylinder? Our mass of the cylindrical object will be actually decreasing, and when if the mass is decreasing, obviously it's whatever the weight will be acting in downward direction, that will be decreasing, and because of that, we will be finding that its terminal velocity of the flow will be decreasing. Okay, which will in turn actually decrease the flow Reynolds number. So particularly if we have to measure the viscosity of low viscous fluids or moderate viscous fluids, in that case, instead of having a solid spherical object, we can go for the hollow cylindrical falling type viscometers. Okay, because we are having advantage of having a hollow tubular section instead of a solid cylinder. Okay, which will be actually meeting our criteria of Reynolds number. Then, so these are the different measurement devices which I have discussed. Apart from that, one important point I would like to highlight that when we do the measurements, we take certain reference values. So let me just describe a few reference values over here. So particularly for liquids, we consider water as our reference, and its viscosity at 20 degrees Celsius is nothing but equal to 1.0016 millipascals second, and this is corresponding to one atmospheric pressure condition. Okay, now we know that nothing but viscosity is a strong function of temperature. For fluids, it changes with temperature. One degree Celsius to 100 degree Celsius at one atmospheric pressure. So we can relate viscosity as ln of mu theta divided by mu at 20 degree Celsius equal to, with the help of this equation. Okay, here theta is nothing but 20 minus T. So whatever the temperature at which we want to actually measure our viscosity. Okay, so this is for liquids, and in case of gases, what we do, we consider nitrogen as our reference fluid for determining the value of viscosity. So for gases, we are nothing but considering nitrogen, and particularly for nitrogen, we are having the value of viscosity as 17.710 plus minus 0.016 micropascals second. Okay, and this particular value is actually applicable for 30 megapascals. Okay, and at a pressure of one atmospheric, if we have to relate the viscosity, it actually can be calculated with the help of density of nitrogen using this particular equation. Okay, so these are the reference fluids which are used for relating the viscosity of liquids and gases to the other fluids. Or even these reference fluids can also be used to determine certain constant terms of our devices. Okay. So with this, I'll stop our discussion over here. And particularly in our next lecture, we will try to discuss the measurement of surface tension.